Hi guys, good morning everyone. So this is Kripakaran Rajendran, founder of No Alma Trading firm Skyrock.in. I have Vishal with me, my friend. So basically, we started this idea of doing a weekly podcast, but instead of talking about general stuff, we thought, okay, we'll specifically focus on trading systems. So this is the first episode where we and Vishal are going to specifically share about mechanical trading systems every week. So every week, we'll take one specific topic and we are going to discuss about it. And in today's topic, we have now taken a specific topic called exit. So with respect to trading systems, why exit matters a lot. And now each of the trading system has its own exit parameters. So we are going to discuss in detail only all about exits. Likewise, every week we are going to discuss about one specific topic where 1 week I'll explain. And next week, Vishal will take up some topic and he'll explain. So this is the idea behind this specific podcast, where every week we are going to do this. So when I discussed this with Vishal, he said, it's fine, we can go on with it. So immediately we started recording the session from today onwards. So every week, I'm sure you will get to learn something about trading systems. So over to you, Vishal.
Thank you. Thanks, Kiru. When you mentioned this, this is a brilliant idea to share what we know in a wider way. So I'll be very honest, Kiru. When sometime back, when I read about blog, I was trying to foray into mechanical systems. And I was just Googling and a blog came prominently on Quora and everyone was Square Off. Okay. So it really dawned on me, everybody talks about entry, but nobody talks about how do we exit. And that's why I selected this topic for you, because when you named your firm as Square Off, it kind of really emphasized the point of how exits are very important in your strategy. So with this, I really wanted to open up to, ask you a question, Kiru. In terms of strategies, we have different kinds of exits. So how important is exits in your view?
Fine. So now to give you a brief, short answer about it, exit is what matters with respect to, your overall profitability. Only when you exit from the trade, you are taking the profits home or you are booking the losses. As long as you're not doing that, it is always going to be a paper. It's going to be an MTM fluctuations. So only the moment you do an exit, and also with respect to exit, you can take any mediocre system or, you can take any moving average systems or anything. But if you could come up with a better exit plans, even you can turn a mediocre system into a better system. But entry, just like entry and exit has to be planned before you even enter the trade, because you should have the worst case scenario as well as you should have you don't need to plan for a best case scenario. You leave the best case scenario to the markets. Plan for the worst case scenario so that even if something happens out of your control, you don't panic and pull out a trigger or do something that is out of the systems. So you always plan all these worst case scenarios and build that into the system. And when that happens, eventually you would be able to stick to the trading systems over the longer period of time. And the main thing is decide your exits accordingly so that you can sleep peacefully at night. That is it. That is what matters with the exit.
So, Kiru, everybody spends tons and tons of time on finding the perfect entry strategy. So I hope today you are going to talk about, as a newcomer who is trying to start a journey into a mechanical system, what are the different kinds of exits that I should be looking at? Can you just elaborate in terms of how anybody who is new to the system try to go about building the exit strategies?
Sure, man. Are you able to see my screen?
Yes, Kiru. We are able to see my screen.
So I have prepared a couple of slides. So why exit is really important with respect to any trading systems. So the first thing is, I will try to explain what are the different trading systems that are actually, people can get started with. And most of the strategies, will fall into any of these three systems, whether it is trend following, mean reversion, or momentum. So if it is a trend following system, people have to ride that trend till it bends. And if it is a mean reversion system, we are trying to act on a short term anomaly where if something is overextended, if some stock has fallen too much, we are trying to get into going long in it. Or if no particular short stock has shot up too much, we are going to short in it. So mean reversion is all about getting into a system and reacting to it immediately and then exiting it very quickly. Trend following system is opposite of mean reversion. So you are entering the trade, but you have to wait for a prolonged period of time so that the trend establishes and it goes on, and finally you are exiting it. Momentum is something like, now it's a kind of a score based or ranking based system. Say suppose you have created a system, but that specific system triggers a 10 stocks or 15 stocks or even 20, multiple trades are triggering or multiple conditions are being satisfied with multiple stocks. So which stock would you go for? You can't simply go for, okay, ITC has triggered a trade or TCS has triggered a trade. So in order to rank a specific number of stocks, if your trading system is triggering, giving you a buy signal for 10 different stocks, out of this 10 stocks, which one would you go for? That is where momentum will come and help you with the ranking score. So based on how much the trend or strength of the trend, you can give a score to each of the stock and pick the top one for going long and pick the bottom one for going short. That is what this momentum is all about. So most of the trend, any of the trading systems will fall only in these three categories, be it pair trading. The pair trading will fall under mean reversion. So whatever the trading systems will come under only these three parts. And with respect to these three parts, we are going to discuss what are the better exit plans. So it is not that only these are going to work. These are something which has been tested and it has proven that it is working. So if someone is mixing a mean reversion and trend following, or if someone is not having a proper exit plans, so whatever things that we are going to discuss in the coming slide will definitely help you to make your system more robust. It is not going to teach you any specific trading system. But if you are having an existing trading system, the coming slides will help you to make it more robust with the pakka exit plans.
Yeah, pakka exit plans. So as we say, trend is your friend until it bends. But how do we know if the trend is bending now?
That is right. So even a short-term down movement can tell you, okay, it is not, bending. It can just tell you that, okay, this particular trend, it could be a pullback to a longer trend. So those things will always happen. So with respect to trend following, mean reversion and momentum, so if I ask you what would be the toughest trading system to trade, what would you say, Vishal?
I would say toughest would be both intraday and long term, because in intraday I will get too many whipsaws, and in long term I will actually get to know that I'm wrong after like 1 year and 1.5 year or 2 years. So both of them, the short terms are the easiest one, right?
That is true. With respect to long term, even we do not know why it is falling. Some stocks like DHFL and S-Bank, it was, by the time we react to it would be too late. But some people know, focus only on the price instead of waiting for the news, they would have gone out. People who always wait for the news to validate, obviously it would be too late for them.
True.
So with respect to exits, we'll cover about what are the different types of exits one can use for intraday trading strategies, followed by short term, if someone is doing a positional trading strategy, what are the different exit plans they can use? And with respect to long term, what are the different quantifiable parameters one can use to exit their long term holdings? So these are the things that we'll discuss about. In case if you have any questions in between, Vishal, you can always ask me then and there.
I will, don't worry.
So first thing with respect to trend following. So trend following is some of the widely used trading strategy, I would say, starting from build and to multiple fund houses, from institutions to individual investors. Most of the people go for trend following because of the huge reward. It is not something that you are going to win every time, because trend following has the least winning accuracy. That too, when you compare it with other trading systems, then on an average trend following winning accuracy would be between 30 to 40%, at the max 45. So if someone is trying to build a trend following system, do not think you can come up with a 60% accuracy, 70% accuracy with the same risk reward ratio. That is very, very difficult. I'm not saying that is impossible, but those kind of systems I have never seen before. Even if I've seen, it was very hard to find such system that is having a higher winning accuracy as well as a higher risk reward ratio. So with respect to trend following systems, I would always say never use the targets. Mm-hmm. Trend following system is all about riding the trends, getting maximum profit out of it. So when you're trying to come out with a fixed target, say suppose super trend, take an example for super trend, that is that can be considered as a trend following system, because once a volatility emerges and once a trend emerges, super trend very neatly captures the complete trend. But most of the beginners try to use a super trend. That is a good thing. But they try to come up with a fixed target. They see, okay, I have made 1,000 rupees profit today. I have made 2,000 rupees profit today. But the problem with trend following is, you know, it is the winning accuracy or this no winning ratio doesn't matter. How much you make when you're right and how much you lose when you're wrong, that decides your overall profitability with respect to trend following. So trend following, if you are using a fixed targets, you are going to cut short your overall profits. So never use targets is one thing, and never use time-based exits for trend following, because there could be two different scenarios. Say suppose you are entering a trade and the trend establishes and the market moves slowly from 9 o'clock to 10 o'clock, it moves to a certain extent. From 10 to 11, it moves to a certain extent. Again, it keeps riding. And by the end of the day, when such kind of trend happens, day end will always end at extreme high. Or if the market is going down, it will, you know, close at the extreme low. That is the usual case with respect to trend following. But what would also happen is, say suppose market goes up, and that too, you know, they all know, always say market goes up like a snail and comes down like a stone. So when you're riding a trend, that too, know, when you're going long and then riding a trend, there will always be certain passes given by the market. So it doesn't go from 100 to 200 instantly. From 100, it will go to 120, and from 120, it will consolidate. Again, from 120, it can go to 150. Likewise, it keeps moving up. So when people use time-based exits, I'm entering a trade, and if the trade is not profitable within the next 1 hour, within the next 30 minutes, I'll close the trade. That wouldn't work much with respect to trend following, because there will always be certain passes that would happen with respect to trend following. So when you're trying to exit, by the time you exit and if the market re-establishes the trend and starts moving up, again, you will miss up a very big trend. So never use the targets and never use a time-based exit with respect to trend following. It can work with other systems, but trend following, you need to give time the trend to establish and know it has to form. So a trend that happens between 9:15 to 3:15, it doesn't happen all of a sudden. It moves slowly and steadily. So it's better to avoid the time-based exits and targets. And the third thing is, with respect to trend following, it clearly follows the Pareto principle. 80% of your profits, even in fact more than 80% of your profits, will come from less than 20% of your trades. That is very, very important factor to consider with respect to trend following. You can take any trading systems which deals with the breakout and trend following system, find out the overall P&L of it, sort it based on descending to ascending order. And if you remove the top 100 trades or top 10% or 20% of your trades, it will overall end up in negative. So when you do a trend following system, if you miss out those big outliers, obviously, you will miss out the trend, you will miss out the complete profits itself. But some people will think that, okay, the trend following system has given a good profits in March 2020 during the corona period, or it has given a good profits during 2008 financial crisis, or it has given a good profit in demonetization or Brexit or even this surgical strike days. So people will try to think that those are something that are extremely rare to happen. So I have to take out those trades from the system and then I'll decide how much it is going to give profits. But when you do that, you are removing all these outliers. Trend following is actually based on these kind of outcomes. So you are waiting for such outcomes to happen. Only those days or those periods are going to give you extreme profits. So when we remove those profits, obviously, you'll end up with a limited profit, or it could end up with a negative overall results. So with respect to trend following, if it is giving you, a consistent loss, 90% of the time you will be under drawdown. So with trend following system, that is what will happen. Most of the time, your equity will be underwater. Once in a while, it will hit a all-time equity high. And by the time the all-time equity high, when it hits, it will be definitely much higher than what you were there in the previous levels. But you have to swim under, the equity has to swim underwater for a prolonged period of time with respect to trend following. So do not worry about those repeated losses that we see with respect to trend following, because that is how it works. Most of the profits will come from very limited number of trades. So you have to make sure you don't miss those trades. So you can't do a paper trading because you have seen 7 streaks of losses. So you wanted to step aside and see 8th and 9th trade out is going, and then 10th trade if you wanted to take the trade. Those 8th and 9th trade which you have moved to paper would have given you enormous profits. So it is better to don't move from paper to live to paper in between. Don't juggle between that, because we never know which trade is going to give you the highest profit.
I think I would really want to jump in here, and I think, sir, I want to really re-emphasize what you just said. Like, a lot of people learn system trading, and they talk about, like, you know, there is something called as luck factor. Okay.
Right.
So what they do is basically take out the top 5 trades or top 10 trades, just to check if you would not have taken those trades, what would have happened to the system. If it is still making money, then it's a robust system. But what you really talked about in the trend following, you cannot. You actually thrive and survive on those, what do you call them, like outliers. So I just want to re-emphasize that, like, you know, in trend following, you should not definitely take out those top 10 or 15 stocks, because I keep on getting a lot of questions sometimes, like, you know, what if you remove top 5 trades if you were not there on demonetization? So, but I think so, it's a brilliant point that you put it up. Kiru.
So that is the main thing with respect to trend following, and with respect to option selling and trend following. So what I would say is, so people, when they deal with option selling with trend following, the problem was, as I said earlier, 80% of your profits will come from 20% of the trades, because those are not just profitable trades, those are extremely profitable trades. And when you deal option selling with trend following, you obviously, it will help you with the theta, no theta decay, whether when it stays with side trend, you know, sideways, or when it goes with your trend. But you can't capture a Nirmala Sitharaman candle with option selling, because that is one such moment where, you know, Bank Nifty moved 2,500 points or more than 2,500 points in one single day. You could only capture whether it's futures or option buying. With option selling, you were even shorting an at the money option of 300 would have gone down to maximum of 10 points or 20 points. So maximum, when Bank Nifty moved 2,500 points, with respect to option selling, you can make maximum 300 points. So trend following, when it specifically relies on these outliers, option selling will limit your overall profit potential.
Okay, Kiru, I have actually a different view here. Maybe it will be benefit. This is how I see it, and I may be completely wrong, but this is how I see it. That what is option selling? Okay, deep out of the money options. Okay, or any out of the money option is going to become zero. Say, assuming it is trading at 400 or 500 rupees, it is going to become zero. So I know, at the end of the day, if it is going to remain out of the money, that trend is going to come in. Okay, so this is how I see it. Maybe I am wrong in my view of things, but like, I believe that trend following would work in option selling. Like, you know, I have been doing this DOS strategy where my primary principle is all out of the money option becomes zero. So they will always have a drift towards the downward side. But yeah, I get your point when you talk about, like, if you are looking for an outliers, it will always come from the option buying or on the future side. But this is how I see it. Maybe I'm different on that.
No. What you said is right, Vishal. So the trend following, you can work with option selling. What I'm saying is, the profit potential that you see with respect to option selling will be limited. Even a short straddle, 920 short straddle, is actually a trend following system. Because you cut short your one side of the legs as soon as the market moves, the other one, it keeps decaying. So obviously you make profit, but that profit wouldn't be 1,000 points or 2,000 points. That would be limited.
So I got your point. It's profit potential that we are talking about. Yeah.
And the next one is with respect to trend following. What I have observed is, when someone says, okay, trailing stop loss doesn't work with respect to intraday or trend following system. When I or someone says that it doesn't work, it is only with respect to their own system. So when I follow a specific breakout trading strategy, I would have tested, okay, trailing stop loss not working. So I go ahead and I say everyone that trailing stop loss doesn't work with intraday. It is not that the case. It is because my own belief with my own system that I have tested it and it is not working fine. It might work with some other trading system. But if same guy is following a same trading strategy being followed by other guy, and then I can say, okay, trailing stop loss might not work, boss, because I have tested it. But when the other person is dealing with completely a different setup and different trend following or breakout system, it can work. So when some people always, whether it can be any influencer or any other person, when someone says that it doesn't work, it is only because with respect to his own testing, with respect to his own systems, if that is not going to be a general statement. So now, when most of the breakout systems, what I have tested is either exit when the stop loss is hit or exit by EOD. When I try to use a trailing stop loss with my own breakout systems, it is limited by overall profit potential. It can increase your winning accuracy towards certain extent because you are now trying to get out as soon as the market reverses. But I'm now ready to lose those market reversal times by using a fixed stop loss, because I use a fixed stop loss and now I'm able to ride the trend till 2 o'clock or till 2:30. All of a sudden trend reverses, and from there it all the way comes down and hits it's my stop loss. Because I'm not using targets here, because I'm not using trailing stop loss, the profits which I have seen till 2:30 has all of a sudden wiped out. You have to ask yourself whether you are comfortable with such things. So you would be seeing MTM. So that too, people who initially get started with systems trading, they'll always keep staring the MTM. So it will be like, okay, 10 o'clock, wow, 10,000 rupees profit. By 12 o'clock, they'll see, wow, it's 20,000 profit. All of a sudden, by 2 o'clock, they'll be like, wow, 50,000 profit. By 2:30, it will be like, oh my God, everything is gone now. From 50,000, it has gone down to minus 20,000. Shit, I should have exited earlier.
In June, everybody has seen that. With all the breakout strategy on Bank Nifty, everything has been doing that only.
That happens with any breakout system or trend following system. So are you okay with such kind of breakout reversals or trend reversals that happens? If you're not okay, better you have to lock the profits with a specific trailing stop loss. Still no targets. Trailing stop loss could help you out, but you should be, accept that overall, your profit potential could be reduced when you're using trailing stop loss with respect to some specific breakout systems. But if you are fine, then I would suggest you to hold it till EOD. Otherwise, when stop losses hit, overall with a larger number of such thousands and 2,000 trades, I could see this has helped with respect to holding it till EOD if the stop loss is not hit.
Interesting.
And with respect to exit points and trend following, so it is not a rocket science. Most of the people I would say are using any of these variations. So if someone is whether it is an intraday trading or a positional trading, if someone is trading based on pivots or higher high and higher lows, usually they use a previous swing lows for going long, and they'll use a previous swing high for going short as a stop loss. When those levels are breached, they'll exit it. So that is one point. And second thing is, fixed stop loss should always in percentage. So some people, when they get started with testing a trading strategy, they'll believe like, okay, I'll use a 50 points with respect to Nifty, 100 points in Bank Nifty, and I'll test it out. If it is working fine, they'll deploy it. But the problem is, see, currently if I use, say, suppose 300 points in Bank Nifty, so that is how much? Just 1%. So when I use a trading strategy with a 300 point stop loss currently, that is just 1% of Bank Nifty movement. If I'm going to deploy this 300 point stop loss as a strategy in 2010 or 11, when Bank Nifty was trading at 10,000 levels, that 300 points is almost 3%. So that is a huge move. So what would happen is, when you're using fixed stop losses, you have the Bank Nifty has to move from 2010 to 2020. In 10 years, it has moved from 10,000 to 30,000. So the same 100 points or 50 point stop loss you use earlier is no more relevant now. Then the same 300 point stop loss we use now is not relevant earlier, because the movement is so wide. So it's always better to go with a percentage stop loss instead of point stop loss. So that is one important thing people have to note. And second thing is, with respect to a trend following, what I have observed is, with respect to intraday, the sooner you enter into a trade, say suppose you are entering into a trade by 9 o'clock or 10 o'clock, but like for an example, your trading system triggers a trade by 9 o'clock or 10 o'clock itself, then there is a higher probability that that particular trade can go wrong. So what I'm trying to convey is, with respect to trend following and that too with respect to an intraday basis, the earlier you get in, the winning accuracy is lower. The later you get in, the winning accuracy is higher. For an example, I know my friend Shakti, who's Quad, the Twitter name is Quad. So he always enters late. So when I talk with him, he always tells me that by 11 or after 10 o'clock only he enters into a trade. That is because he's waiting for the trend to emerge. So by 9:15 to 11:15, you have 2 hours of time. So by 2 hours, when you wait and trigger the trade after 11:15, you are actually waiting for the trade to emerge, I mean the trend to establish, and then you are getting into a trade. So there is a higher probability that that trend can continue to go on. So the intraday trend strategy that we derived at Square of Watts, that is based on this principle. So we are entering a trade after 2 hours of the market opens because we are waiting for the noise to get settled. And second thing, we are giving 2 hours of time. You are giving enough time for the markets or the stock to establish the trend, and then you are getting into a trade. This kind of late entry towards a trend following can give you a higher accuracy, but can limit you the overall profit potential because by 9:15 to 11:15, it would have already established a trend. So certainly you are missing it, and the rest of the thing only you are capturing it. So that gives you higher accuracy but lesser profits. So a person who is entering earlier, that gives them an enormous profit in their right, but you have to be wrong multiple times because the stop loss gets hit, the trend gets reversed by 9:30, trend gets reversed by 10 o'clock. So that happens once in a while. So trend following, the later you enter, higher probability. The earlier you enter, it has a lesser probability, but higher, overall profits potential would be higher.
This is respect to the intraday, right? This is
Right,
respect to the intraday. Yeah.
and with respect to exits, ATR can also be used as an exit. So instead of fixed stop loss percentage is one thing, ATR based exits is another thing. So you can, that gives you a volatility factor. So people know currently market is extremely at low volatility. It is almost like part two of 2017. So the markets, as long as keeps trading in the lower volatility band, the number of times it is going towards a trend or number of times it is establishing a trend will be very, very minimal. So what people can do is find out the ATR levels or ATR percentage. Convert the ATR into percentage always. So ATR bank Nifty is giving 100 points, 200 points, means convert that into a percentage basis and compare that ATR percentage with respect to your bank Nifty or Nifty. So what I would say is, hey, instead of using a 0.5% stop loss, 0.1% stop loss, use ATR as a base and see, okay, if 2x ATR happens from open, or 2x ATR happens, or 3x ATR happens from my entry point, you can exit or book profits. So these ATR based exits will factor in the volatility, and then you can plan up your exits. So if someone wanted to exit based on price, go for fixed stop loss. Someone wanted to enter exit based on volatility, go for ATR. Simple.
So Kiru, you talked about ATR percentage. Is
Right.
it different from the ATR? How that works?
So ATR percentage is simple, man. So what you do is, say suppose if you're considering it based on intraday trading systems and you wanted to use an ATR percentage, you are checking the ATR levels. So ATR levels would be 200 points or 300 points. Consider 300 points as ATR. Now you divide this 300 by Bank Nifty open price. Say suppose Bank Nifty open price is 33,000. So which means that you in this 300 points compared to 33,000, what is the overall percentage? That is what it, you can
Okay.
easily plot in AMI broker or any charting platform. So you convert
Interesting.
that into percentage and then do it. Because as I said earlier, when you find certain system, okay, you believe that okay, ATR 250 or 300 is good levels for an exit, you have to find out what that ATR is in percentage in 2010 or 11. So that when you test for 10 years or 12 years, it gives you a better exit plans instead of going for the ATR points.
Awesome.
And the next one with respect to positional is simple, the last N bar high and low. Say suppose someone is not trading based on a short-term positional basis, they can use last 22 days high or 22 days low as a trailing stop loss and then exit it. That is because 22 days is your overall 1 month period. So because we have 22 trading days in a month, right?
Yep.
Right. So yeah, you can use the last N bar high or N bar low as an exit parameter for positional trend following systems. And for long term, I would definitely go with this 52-week high low values. So once the stock breaks 52-week low, you exit out of it. Though that is something where a long-term investor will give enough room for all the fluctuations to happen. Stocks like DHFL and Yes Bank, they would have gotten out when this 52-week low was it, because the 52-week low was it. Not when the stock was down 80-90%. It was when it was down by 50% itself, this slowed a bit. And also people don't give much importance to all-time high. a stock that is hitting a all time high is a very, very good entry parameter, I would say. So that is something that, it is like the Reliance Industries was almost for 8 years, it was trading flat. But the moment it hit, came out of that specific resistance zone and hit an all time high, it went up like a blast. That happens with most of the stocks I have seen. Mm-hmm. And to the long term, I would definitely go with this 52 week low point. Or no, 52 after 52 week low, only the all time low will come. So even if the all time low is hit, and if you're still waiting for the stock to get out, it's worse fun. So it's always to come out. And second, most of the thing I would say is the long term holdings is like forever. It's not like 5 years or 10 years. So when I purchase a stock, I would think that okay, just like if once I'm out of this world, most of the people are going to give their son or daughter, whether it is an asset as a house or a flat or a plot. But what I would say is, okay, these are the stocks that has been an asset where you can use it. So that is my long-term holdings. That I'll hold it forever. But I'll exit it the moment I see some smoke out of it. I don't wait for a fire to show up. So the moment you see some corporate governance issues, you have to come out of it. So long-term holdings stock is all about the person who is running the company. That is more than price, more than fundamentals. It's all about, see, Amazon is Amazon not because of the e-commerce, it's because of Jeff Bezos. Similarly, Microsoft is there as a the topmost B2B company. It's not because of their Windows, it's because of Bill Gates. So it's primarily the people who are running the company decides the future of it. So as long as I have the conviction, okay, this particular person is caliber to run this company and who are all the investors, I'll enter into the stock. As long as my my statement is valid, I hold on to it. If something happens to these persons, or if there is any change in leadership, or if something is not going as per my own conviction, which I've entered into the stock, I'll come out. This is something this is something which cannot be quantified. This has to come by your own experience. So for an example, I have invested in Apple. So when I invested in Apple, I know there is a company called Apple, but I did not know what that company was doing. But then I thought, okay, I have to this is for in search of multi-bagger I was doing, okay, what are the things I should do? Eventually, when I came to know about Apple, I wanted to get into a stock which I can understand the business. So even though this power sector stock, Adani Green and another energy and all these stocks, our momentum stocks are going up to a greater extent, I was not comfortable because first thing is I don't understand the business. And second thing, I wanted to get into a business which is asset light. For an example, it doesn't need much capital. It shouldn't be capital intensive business. So when I searched about Apple, it was a kind of a communications company, which primarily deals with OTT and it's kind of a B2B segment where they have their own algorithm. And based on their own algorithm, they are giving in services to these B2B clients. What attracted to me the most was 10, 15 years before itself, Microsoft invested in Apple when it was a startup. Oh, so when Microsoft itself invested in startup in Apple, why shouldn't I? So I immediately said, okay, I should invest in it. Then that's it. So Apple, I invested in it it was around 1,200 levels. Now it is 5,000 levels, but I did not even feel like booking the profits. I thought, let it run as long as the conviction I have. So long-term holdings is, if you wanted to go by quantifiable rules, this 52-week low would be a better point. Otherwise, go with the corporate.
No, I think so. We have spent a good deal on the trend following before we jump into the other ones. But I really wanted to take your view because few of the guys have talked about it and wanted to talk your view also. Say if I'm doing a trend following on intraday, because the time is very limited till 3:30, do you think it makes sense to say, assuming I'm using a trailing stop loss, say after 2 o'clock, I start tightening my trailing stop losses because the time that I'm going to give from 2 to 3 o'clock is pretty very small. So I know Madan has talked about it. I know Pawan, who is a good friend of mine, also talked about it. So I just wanted to take your view on that as well.
Yes, that definitely helps. As you said, because we have 6 hours of time in intraday, and in that 6 hours time, probably we will wait for 1 hour for the trend to establish. So remaining 5 hours or 4 hours only we have. So you can move your stop loss towards the cost, and from there, from 1 hour you can increase it to 2 or 3 hour. So that level you can trail it, and as you said, the closer you are to the market closing hours, you can make it very nearer to your enterprise and try to lock the profits as much as possible once you're near the day. So that would keep you out of those surprises that I said earlier. So when the market reverses, you will be in a better position to come out of the profits when you're trailing it to a very closer extent after 2 o'clock or 2:30.
Awesome.
So I think we have almost for the last 40 minutes, we've spent it time following itself, man. We'll go with the introduction. So
yeah.
That's I'll try to, because we actually started this session with closing it with 30 minutes. I don't think we can close it in 30 minutes.
No way. Because we have so much to share as well.
Yeah. So we'll go with mean reversion. So mean reversion is all about getting into a trade when something goes out of range. It's kind of a rubber band. So when you don't try to move that particular, when a particular stock moves to a greater extent in shorter span of time, it has to revert to mean. So that is what mean reversion is all about. And when you use a mean reversion strategy, it is better to exit quick compared to trend following. Trend following, you always wait and then exit. Mean reversion, it is better to exit as quickly as possible, because that is something which will be there for only shorter period of time. Eventually, the stock which is extended to a greater extent, like for an example, a stock moving from 100 to 120 within just 5 minutes, and stock dropping from 100 to 80 within 5 minutes is something that doesn't happen very rarely. I mean, very regularly. So when that happens, you have to get into it and get up very fast. So mean reversion is very short term anomaly, and you have to get in and get out very quickly. And second thing is always better to use a fixed target with the mean reversion. So instead of using a trailing stop losses, or instead of waiting for the a bigger trend and then trying to close out, don't mix trend following with mean reversion. Suppose you are shorting a stock and then it is dropping, don't keep riding it until the trend bends. That is trend following. With mean reversion, the moment it shorts, goes down, get into it. Whether you are buying, mean reversion is all about when it falls, buying it, and when it goes up, shorting it. So that is what mean reversion is all about. So when it falls down, it's kind of a dead cat's bounce. It can fall down and again you can shoot up. So the period, say suppose it was almost related to your physics, what you have studied. They're putting a ball here and then it falls down, and then from here the surface, it can make maximum, it can go up to 50 or 60% of the height. And second time if the ball falls, again only half of the length it will go down, go up. And again, after it hits the surface, that's all. The momentum will slow down and then it doesn't rise up. So mean reversion is all about capturing that first fall. The moment it falls, it can raise up again to a certain extent. So when it falls, buy it. When it moves up to a certain extent, exit. So that is where I've created a strategy called stop hunt. So stop hunt is mainly based on that structure. I wait for the stock to go down to a greater extent at a shorter span of time, and I'll get into it and get out quickly. So mean reversion is all about getting in and getting out quickly with the fixed targets. And good thing with mean reversion is there is no outliers. So it is not like trend following where 80% of your profits comes from 20% of the trades. Mean reversion can it can have an equally distributed profit and loss scenarios. So one trade or two trades is not going to break you if you use a fixed stop loss. And when you use a fixed stop loss plus fixed targets, your P&L will be very smooth, just like how your RSI intraday strategy. That doesn't have much outliers. That gives you a good equity curve over a longer period of time. And as I said earlier, with regards to mean reversion and intraday, don't wait for EOD, because mean reversion is all about quicker movements. So don't wait for EOD. As soon as the fixed targets or stop loss is it, better to come out of it. And when you're dealing with positional short strategies, that too with kind of mean reversion. For an example, say suppose you are shorting a stock that is going up, and buying a stock that is going up and shorting a stock that is going down. So together you are trading it, and there will always be certain worst case scenario. Say suppose a guy who is buying Bharti Airtel and shorting Arcom. What would happen is Bharti Airtel would have gone up to 20%. This Arcom was drastically going down, but the Arcom, which is moved down from 800 rupees to almost 0 rupees now, if you have checked the chart, there were more than 4 instances where Arcom moved up more than 100%. So from 20 it moved to 40. From 40, when it was at 40, it moved to 80. So when it was 10, it moved to 12. So when you are a short trader, and when you are not get captured in these short squeezes, that's all, you are going to blow out. So you have to be very, very careful with respect to main reversion strategy when you deal with such stocks, because obviously the movement is going to be very wild, and when you're dealing with shorts with mean reversion. So that is why you always say come out with fixed targets and fixed stop loss with mean reversion. Just react to it very quick and come out of it. And the next part,
Kiru, one question once again, before we jump to the mean reversion, because first of all, do you have a time-based exit? Should we use a time-based exit for the mean reversion?
Time-based exits will work, because with respect to mean reversion, it has to act quick, right? So you are not trying to buy a stock that goes down, and within specific time it doesn't come up, it means that it has lost its, you know, velocity. So it
moment
can go,
okay.
So it can turn into be a momentum. So from mean reversion can turn into be a momentum. So it's okay. Better to the fix, no time-based exits also with respect to mean reversion.
And secondly, Larry Connors and quite a few people have done a lot of research on stop losses with mean reversion, and what they figured out that keeping a stop loss as far as 50% to 100% also actually deteriorates the performance of a mean reversion. So we being a trader, we always have to have a stop loss. So what if a trader wants to put in stop loss, how would he decide the stop loss when it comes to mean reversion?
Stop loss is all about, you know, say suppose I'll give you an example. Yeah, stock is trading at 100 rupees and all of a sudden it has come down to 90 rupees. A 10% fall has happened. Now I would suggest you to go with the 5% target. Mm-hmm. So your target is 5%, half of what it has fallen. Use a stop loss which is higher than this specific target. So if your target if your stop loss is 5%, use a target. Sorry, I'm confused. No. 100 rupees is the price. It has fallen down to 90, which is a 10% fall. Keep that half of that as your target, which is 5%. Okay. And then at least use 1.2 or 1.3 times as a stop loss. So you are leaving enough room for the stock to move against. So it has gone down. And most of the time when it gone down to a greater extent at short span of time, it will come up. Otherwise, it can go down further. So you can always use 1.2 times or at least the same levels, whatever the levels you used as your stop loss level. You can use the same thing also as your targets and stop loss. So it can be same or it can be a little bit higher so that you're giving enough room to go against you and you're trying to capture it. So stop loss targets can be same or it can be a little bit higher.
Perfect.
So that is all you wanted to cover with mean reversion. So momentum is, as I said earlier, it is a much simpler concept when you are dealing with multiple stocks. So you have to rank it based on whatever the parameters. For an example, you have 10 stocks. You wanted to know which stock to get in. So all these 10 stocks has performed very well. Find out which stock has performed the best in the last 12 months or 6 months. And then you are getting into that top one stock or top two stock. That is what this momentum is all about. So momentum is like a stock that goes higher can keep go higher. No, a stock that goes lower can keep go lower as long as the momentum continues. So with respect to momentum, most of the people first, it helps in ranking the stock on based on the higher ranking or based on the lower ranking, they go long or go short. And second thing, most of the people with respect to momentum traders, they don't use a fixed stop loss. Instead, they use this rebalancing concept. For an example, if I'm going to get into this momentum trading right now, I wanted to get into a stock which has performed well in the past for last 1 year. And I pull up the Nifty 50 data and I see, okay, Adani Green has performed well. So I get into the stock because it is momentumly, that is the top stock. Now I enter into the stock this month. Now I don't use a fixed stop loss. I don't use any trailing stop loss here. All I have to do is run the same simulation next month and see which specific stock is, just a second. My battery is running out. So which specific stock is coming up at the top again next month? So if it is Adani, you are going to keep it. Instead of Adani, if it is, say, suppose Power Grid or some other stock, you are going to close Adani and then entering into Power Grid. You are repeating the same thing month after month. So most of the momentum traders, they go only with the rebalance. And where I have spent so much of time in 2018 and 19 with the momentum based rules. And what I have observed is fixed stop loss doesn't help much with momentum. So I can buy an Adani stock. I have to do is give them enough time for the stock to move. Because as I said earlier, when the stock doesn't move swiftly from here to there, there will be certain consolidation that can happen. So with the momentum, when you're giving enough time, so I'm entering into a trade in January. After 6 months, I'm going to rebalance the portfolio. I am giving 6 months of time to this momentum stock to react. When I give such a long period, there is a higher probability that it can go up still further. And also it can go to a larger extent. It's not going to be, 5% or 10% more. There is a higher probability that it can go 60% or 50% also. So when I do the rebalancing with a long-term approach of, at least, halfly to yearly, there is two good things. That first thing is you're giving enough room for the stock to move. And second thing, your transaction cost goes down drastically because the rebalancing is just 2 times a year. And you don't need to worry about all these movements that is happening in the day-to-day basis. Because entering into January and next by June only, I'm going to check it out. And then by December only, I'm going to check it out. So in a year, only 2 times, I'm going to sit in front of the system. That helps psychologically and also profitability wise it helps. But only thing is, when your momentum changes, your drawdown could be a bit higher. Say suppose you're entering a stock by January in 2008, consider, and you are exiting the trade by June 2008 because of certain global financial crisis that happened that year, your losses would have been at a greater extent because we are exiting after 6 months. When I compare the same thing with short-term rebalancing, where you are exiting in a month, I'm entering into a trade by January and exiting by the month end itself. So what would happen there is I'm limiting the losses because I'm coming out as soon as possible. And next month when I'm trying to run this momentum factor, there because of that crashes, most of the stocks, the momentum score would have gone down. So only some stocks could have come up. Well, and so the number of trades could be limited. So only when the market, as long as it goes in a bullish phase, you'll have certain stocks that satisfies this condition. If the market gets into those bearish phase, you'll have only short trades. You'll not have any long trades. But overall, when I compared the short-term rebalancing with the long-term rebalancing, long-term rebalancing really helps with respect to drawdown, with respect to profitability factor, and with respect to transaction cost. Short-term will always be more of a noise. So if you're dealing with momentum, I would recommend to go switch over to a higher rebalancing period than a short-term rebalancing period. So when you test that with 5 to 10 years of data sets, you would know that long-term rebalancing is better.
Okay. Kiru, one question here. When you rank the stocks, say I'm going to take the top 20 stocks and say after the year, like half year, those are not the top 20, maybe 5 of them got dropped out. Okay, but they're still in that top 10, how do I put it? So we took the first top 10, we bought top 10 stocks. When the 6 months got over, they were in the top 20, but they were not the part of the top 10.
Okay.
Do you still get out of that?
You get out of that. Because your rule is to stick to top 10. So whether it is in top 20 or top 30 or top 40, you're not least bothered about it. Whichever is top 10, I'm going to enter into it. If it is not there in the top 10, I'm going to exit out of it. That's all. So you have to decide the number of stocks that you're going to hold. And the interesting observation I have seen is you can have 10 stocks, 20 stocks, 30 stocks of your portfolio. The momentum will also follow the Pareto principle. Instead of 30 stocks, if you trade with the top 3 stocks, you will still get whatever the profits you could make with the 30 stocks. And that I have checked with the vast number of data sets. I could still see that I have tested with almost 2008 to 2021 data sets. I could see instead of going with top 10, top 20, 30, as long as I increase the number of stocks, people think that it will help them to diversify. But instead of going that, if you stick to top 3 itself, that will give you the same profits. So why should I trade with 30 stocks and increase my transaction cost? So with respect to momentum, it's better to go with the top, the lower number of stocks, better it is.
Okay, interesting.
So that is momentum. And the final interesting part is this option buying and option selling. So there is always a war that will happen in Twitter once in a while. So I'll try to explain with respect to options buying and option selling. So with options buying, whatever the trading system we have, we should be prepared with streaks of losses. That is the first and foremost thing. People can say that is margin benefit, whatever it is. you should be ready to face 7, 8, 9, 10 losses consecutively with respect to option buying. That will definitely happen, and that too with the scenario like today. I mean, these days where the ATR is going low, volatility is going low, option buying will have streaks of losses. And as I said, with respect to trend following, option buying is also dependent on outliers. So you need to have days like Nirmala Sitharaman candle or some other days where the option buying based strategy is largely dependent on those kind of outliers, because option buying is almost like trend following. You will be right only 1 out of 3 times. With option selling, you will be right 2 out of 3 times. As I said earlier, where market can go up or can go down or can stay sideways. So only when you are right, you are going to make profit with option buy. The other two cases, when you are wrong or even if it stays sideways, we are going to lose with option buying. And the other thing what I've observed is Mondays and Fridays has a higher profit factors compared to all other days. It could be because of two scenarios. One is that is going to be the startup expiry on Friday. So obviously the theta decay could be little lower. Monday being the day that opens up after weekdays. So the large movement that I have observed, even if you could not check your historical data, you could see Black Monday and Black Friday. You won't see a Black Wednesday or a Black Thursday, Black expiry. So those things happens very rare. That is because of the weekend effect. So most people wanted to close out their positions before the weekend, so the Friday could be a big momentum day. And because of certain geopolitical events that happens in overnight, during the weekend, Monday could be a trending day. So profit factor increases when someone deals with option buying on only these 2 days. So if you have a specific trading strategy, you can do a postmortem analysis with your trading strategy on day wise and see where the higher profit factors comes from. So even though dependent on outliers, we cannot afford to miss a big trending day on Tuesdays or Wednesdays. Still, option buying is going to work against you when you are trying to buy it near to the expiry. Obviously, on Thursdays, on Fridays, even someone who trades based on futures, and if I'm trying to trade on options buying, obviously when it triggers on Thursdays, I'll know okay, today's it's swaga gone. That is what I'll have when my golden ratio got triggers a trade on Thursday. I'll know okay, today's swaga 2% gone. But once in a while, that 2% can move to 4% or extent. But most of the times, it can happen. So Mondays and Fridays gives you a higher profit factor. And as I said earlier, theta decay can hit your trading stop loss. So what happens is when you're using a trailing stop loss with option buying, so as long as it goes up, it's fine. But options will always give you these spikes, sudden up spike or sudden down spike. And again, it will revert. So that kind of spikes will definitely hit your trailing stop loss. So option buying, again, you have to check with respect to your own trading system. If it helps, you can use a trailing stop loss. But what I have observed is with respect to my system, it did not help much, the trailing stop loss in option buying. And again, don't use targets with respect to option buying. So option buying with respect to trend following or breakout system, again, if you're using a fixed targets, you're limiting your overall profit potential with profit option buying. So you have to ride the trend. So when you are dealing with the trend following and breakout system, don't use the targets even if it is option buying. Coming to option selling, time is money. So the longer you hold, you are going to make profits with respect to option selling. So I would always recommend to hold it for a longer period of time when you're dealing with option selling, because 2 out of 3 scenarios, you're going to make profits. When you're right, you're going to make profit. Even when the market stays in sideways, we are going to make profit. Only you are going to be lose when the market is going against you. So with respect to option selling, time is money. So hold it for a longer period of time to get the complete theta decay. And as I said earlier, if you are trading with the trend following system with option selling, it can help to a certain extent, but it can limit your overall profit potential. So if you have created a trading system which is based on futures, and if you wanted to apply the same strategy in options, then I would recommend to go for option buying rather than option selling, because trend following always lay on outliers. So when you develop such trading system which is based on futures and wanted to implement in options, go for option buying then selling. And with respect to option selling, I have observed that fixed stop loss does wonders than complicated adjustments. So you can have a exit as a specific fixed level. When that reaches, come out of it. Or else people do adjustments, or no, they have this next week leg or next month expiry. I don't understand all those parts, but what I have tested it out is using a fixed stop loss gives you, you know, a peaceful mind. Okay, when that hits, I'm going to come out of it. Otherwise, no, obviously, I'm going to hold it till the end of the day. I'm going to make profit out of theta decay. So instead of using complicated adjustments, using a fixed stop loss has, you know, given a higher profit factor with respect to option selling. Even that worked well when this 2018 world megadon happens. So if you go back and check in 2018 news about it, there were two companies, LJM Partners and Patton Funds. So these are the two companies which were actually doing in option selling based strategies. These are actually in hedge funds, which were primarily based out of US. 2017 was extreme low volatility period. So most of the people were increasing their leverage by the end of 2017 because they were using enormous profits from option selling itself. So there is this company called LJM Partners who were dealing with no option selling, and they took over leverage and they were actually making tons of money. By 2018 February, there was extreme volatility that happened in, you know, just within
natural
short
time.
LJM Partners or LJM Partners, I think. LJM,
yeah,
or
yeah.
I
think so. It was the commodity options, maybe, if I remember. No, okay.
So they did that, and what happened was, no, they were losing money very fast. So at the start of February, they were having $880 million. So by the end of February, it was down to $14 million. So they lost everything in just 1 month of time, trying to, you know, do the firefighting part with their options. So instead of coming out, they were, you know, doing multiple adjustments and they couldn't control it. And by the time end of the February month, they sent out a letter to all their investors stating that they have lost because of sudden, you know, volatility, you know, burst that happened. And the same option selling strategy being followed by Patton Funds. So Patton Funds is another fund. They, because, well, no, volatility is applicable to all the fund houses. It's not that only to that fund house it happened. It happened to the entire world. But the other guy, Patton Funds, what he did is they had the same scenarios, they had the same legs, but they had a certain fixed stop loss levels. When that level is breached, when, you know, they were losing certain levels, and they immediately came out of it. They did not use any other adjustments because they were ready to accept the losses and they came out. So what I'm trying to convey is there was, you know, these two firms were dealing with multi-million dollars, and one company completely shut down because of, you know, they couldn't handle the volatility by trying to making the strategy more complicated with multiple adjustments. Other company, they were able to, you know, simply cut short the losses. So fixed stop loss with option selling is will do wonders, definitely complicated, you know, compared to the complicated adjustments. And, you know, people who are trying to use the hedges, say they are dealing with short straddle strategy, and all of a sudden now you need 2 lakhs as a margin. So if you use a hedged position, your margin from 2 lakhs gets reduced to 30,000. So most people will think that, okay, let me go with the hedges. But they should understand that hedging will reduce your profits drastically. You're not going to get the same profits that you are making without hedging. So hedging will reduce your profits drastically. So you have to test your system and see whether or no, you know, using hedge will still get you the hedge. Otherwise, don't go for hedge. And the last one I would say is, focus on open interest for exits. That is something interesting which I've observed recently, where instead of price, say suppose, you know, I have shorted at 300 rupees or 100 rupees, whatever the price levels, instead of, you know, based on the price movements, if I'm exiting and if I'm using a open interest and then I'm exiting based on open interest level, the open interest gives me a far better, you know, exit levels compared to the price levels. So when I tested it for a longer period of time, this OA has certain, you know, directional nature, where, you know, checking the OAs and then trying to exit based on whatever changes that is happening in OA will give you a better exit than price based exits.
Can you so give me an example, Kiru?
Say suppose, you know, when there is a fall in OA that happens, usually this OA changes happens on the expiry days. So when you're shorting a specific strike and then you are seeing, okay, the under from 100 it is moving to 105 or 110, slowly it is moving against your trend. You're shorted it and it is moving up. If you, you know, go and check the OA, it would be dropping slowly. Because people who were shorted at the beginning of the expiry will be trying to cover it back. So there would be a fall in OA on the expiry days. And, you know, those sudden OTM options, which is trading at, you know, 10 rupees, 50 rupees, moving up suddenly, you know, to 80 rupees, 100 rupees, that would happen because of this fall in OA. So you can even simply test it out. What would happen if I buy a specific option if there is a fall in OI within 5 minutes? Simple. So if there is a fall in OI, say suppose a 20% OI has fallen within 5 minutes in any of the options, right? Go and buy that. There will be a higher probability that the OI keeps falling and the price keeps rising. That happens because of the square off that happens from the large fund houses and other institutions who wanted to close that position.
So that happens from square off of large fund houses. The square off is doing all this OI based trading.
No man, we just started exploring it. So I wanted to create more strategies based out of the alternate data set is available, like OI, IVs. So whatever that is with respect to not price, I wanted to focus on the other parts. So when I was dealing with that, this way gave a better plans.
Interesting. Very interesting.
So that is all I think I wanted to cover. So if you have any questions, you can ask me now.
No, I think so. I've asked the questions in between. But what we really love is the viewers to put down any questions that we are going to post it out, and any of the topic that you are interested in. So from a mechanical standpoint of view, so if you can put out your points on comment section, so we'll definitely go through them and we'll select one of the topic that we think can be interesting, and in the due course we will try to cover all the points that we wanted. But I think so, Kiru, this is a brilliant initiative that we have started with, and that is definitely going to help us and help them as well.
Sure, man. As long as we don't get boozed on Saturdays and get sloshed, so hopefully, we have to change our drinking plans on the weekdays instead of on weekends going forward if we have to do the session continuously. So yeah, the idea behind this session is to make it more easily understandable certain concepts with respect to, because there is a lot of things that is already available in YouTube which focuses on basic. And there is a lot of things which is already available which focuses on advanced, but there is certain only limited number of videos are there which explains in depth about certain points. So that is why I wanted to cover specifically about this trading systems. So people can, if in case people have any questions with whatever things we have discussed, they can post it in comment section. So myself or Vishal can clarify that. So going forward, we'll come up with different videos every week. So, and moreover, it is actually enjoyable discussing about markets always. So it's not at all boring. Trading is boring, but discussing about all these things is not at all boring. Exactly.
And it's a lonely business. At least on a Saturday, I get to speak to you at least.
Definitely, man. This is actually it was a lonely business, and now other people has also joined because of Corona, and all these people are working from home only. So most of the people are dealing with lonely business.
So true. So let's catch up next week and with an interesting topic for us, and then we can take it up from there.
Sure, Vijay. We'll keep in touch. Bye, man.